of a yes, we can. You change a lot more than a man. See the power of a dream, it changes things. Yeah. The promise down upon the cross. A promise that will save the lost.
Welcome to the Promise Talk Show. I am your host, Dr. Roberta Washington, and I am excited today. We have an amazing show for you today. I want you to get ready, get excited. Go ahead, like, tag, and share with your friends. Like, tag, and share to the Promise Talk Show. Y'all just don't know how excited I am today because this is my family that we have on the show today. So I am so excited to get this show started today. First, the Promise Talk Show. We host different guests. We host authors. We host those who have their own ministries, business owners. We want to make sure that we get the information out to our community. We host nurses, doctors, whatever there is that's going on in our nation, in our community. We want to make sure that we keep you updated and we keep you current. We are hosted by the amazing Boss Up Houston. So we want to give a shout out to Boss Up Houston and Ms. Shamir Bacon for hosting us, the Promise Talk Show. And our scripture today is 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. The Bible says that the promises of God are yes, and in him, amen. On today, we have Millennial Conversations. I know that every pastor that I know should want to be on this listening to this talk show today, because we have Millennial Conversations. Y'all, like I said, this is my family, and this is something that they've been coming together, just getting that information out there, and it has truly been a blessing. It has been such a blessing to me that I wanted to bring it to you, because as a pastor, we need to know how to be current, how to be relevant, how to be able to bring the millennials into the conversation as we talk about the church and the Bible, and as we're using this amazing tool that God left us called fellowship in the church. We are the church, but we fellowship together. And the millennials are here today to answer some of those needed, necessary questions that we have. Now, as we get started, I want to start with this amazing woman of God. Y'all have seen her before, and you'll probably see her again, but she is one of the she's in the pit. She's a pastor in training at Emmanuel Worship Center. So I want to introduce to some and present to others, pastor in training, Angela Francis. Go ahead and introduce yourselves today.
Good evening. Good evening. Now, we are really excited to be here. It is such a blessing and such an awesome testament of what God is doing, the new things that God is doing on the earth. I am Angela Francis, as Pastor Roberta said. I am the youth director, praise and worship team leader, business owner, all of that. And I have the honor of introducing my children, who are awesome men and women of God, who they actually came up with this venue, this avenue of talking about millennials and what is going on with the church. And I believe that these five, one of them is not here, but I believe that these five are on the verge of something miraculous. And they are very smart, intelligent, God-fearing kids. The first one, I'm going to go from the oldest to the youngest, I think. The oldest is Jarrell Beckett. He is actually my son. He is my oldest son, Jarrell Beckett. He is a media and social media consultant, executive assistant at God's Temple of Praise Community Church, pastors Melvin and Nina Johnson. Then I'm going to go over here to Christian, Pastor Christian Deshaun Monday. He don't like when I do that, but Deshaun. He is the pastor under the leadership of Apostle Lisa Brown, but he is the pastor of Altar of Fire International Ministries. Praise God. So we're glad to have him. Aaron is not on here. We bless God for him. He is actually in a church meeting right now, but my youngest is Aaron Daniel Solomon. And then I'm going to introduce my two gorgeous baby girls over here. These are actually my goddaughters, but I definitely treat them as my children. And so the Micah Chavance, by way of Michelle and Mr. and Mrs. Chavance, is my baby. And she is just all around. She's a minister. She's actually, yes. She's a minister. She's a praise dancer. She's all of that. She's a worshiper. And then last but certainly not least, the youngest of the bunch is Maya Ross. She is very active at Greater Vision Church. I'm sorry, I forgot to say Micah is at Southwest Community Baptist Church, Reverend Greg Patrick. And then Maya is under Pastor L.D. Lee. Her mother and I have been friends for 20-something years. She's my god baby. She's awesome and talented. And she's that quiet storm, Pastor. She's the quiet storm over there in the corner. She don't say much, but when she does, it's definitely a word.
Amen. I'm excited to have y'all on because, again, y'all are family to me. We've been, for as far as myself and Miss Angela, we have been connected and family, I would say now probably more than 20 years, more than 20-something years. And so I always say it, and she always stops me. She tries to, she can't stop me. But although she assists at Emmanuel Worship Center, I always like to remind people that she was one of my teachers in ministry when I was just a babe in Christ, just like the millennials here. Actually, at least they know the direction that they're going in because most of them are in ministry. I had no clue. I was just trying to find my way. And it's just amazing what God will do in keeping people in covenant with each other. So I would say this too, stop disconnecting with people just because y'all don't go to the same church. That is so childish. So don't do that. We are all family, regardless of which building we're sitting in. Amen. We're the church. And so I do want to ask one follow-up question to you, Pastor and Trainer Angela. She told me, I'm going to drive her crazy with that, but that's all right. But I want to ask you another question. What made this become so important for you to do, to have these millennial conversations? What was the drawing force other than these are your children?
Other than these are my children, they were the ones who brought it to me, but I find just from my background and the things that I've been through with throughout my life and being a pastor's kid and growing up in church, a lot of times our voice was not being heard when we were young, such as their ages. A lot of times the word talks about not despising your youth, but it seems like we still, even though it's in the word, I don't think we actually do it. I don't think we actually hear their hearts, their minds, their souls. And we think that all the time we have to, that we need to guide them. But a lot of times God is already leading them in the directions. God is already leading them in different directions to speak and to be, and they have a lot to say. And I believe that now is the time that we have to start listening to the millennials. This is our next generation. This is the next church. This is the next pastors, the next leaders, the next deacons, you know, all of that. And if we don't allow to hear their voice, it's like we're smothering them. I believe that we're smothering the gift that God has given them. And so what was important to me is not only because these are my children and I've always taught them to speak their mind. It's just the way you speak your mind. They've always been taught that, both me and their dad. And so I really believe that this is the next revival, that the revival is going to come through the millennials, through these young people. That is because we've gotten so caught up in tradition. We've gotten, as adults, we've gotten caught up in tradition and how it's supposed to look. It doesn't have to look anyway, except like Jesus. That's it. That's the only way it needs to look is like Jesus. And so it was important for me to let them know that I'm here for them and that I'm here to not just facilitate, not just, you know, say, oh no, that's not right, but to hear them and to adhere and move forward. Some of that. And there's too many millennials that are dying right now, Pastor.
Amen. Well, I also want to say, y'all, this is so special to me too, because when we met, they were all little bitty kids. Actually, Michael wasn't even born. So they were very small. And so to see them grow today, I want to say also, this is also an example to parents, to let you know, those of you that keep your children a part of the local assembly, where they can actually grow in the Lord, because they, not being pushed or prodded, they have a desire to follow the Lord. And so I want to start with our first conversation, and I want to start today, let me just make sure. I want to start today with, let's go with Minister Micah. Amen. She is a minister. Amen. And I want to ask you, is this the generation that seeks him? Is this the generation?
Hello, everybody. Good evening. Nice to see you all. Y'all's lovely faces. I love seeing y'all. We love talking to my siblings and everybody. Thank you, Pastor Roberta, and for everybody, you know, inviting us to the show. One thing that I do think, I believe that this is the generation that seeks him. And I think, so to say, this is the best generation to do so. There is a fire that I can attest, not only for myself, but for the youth that I work with too, that there's a fire. You know, you hear this fire shut up in my bones. Literally, this generation is on fire. It's something completely different that's never been seen. And so with, not even just with our platform that we've created, which, by the way, y'all, we make a year on April 3rd. So April 3rd, we've been on this thing for a year. Millennial Conversation has been doing the thing for this whole thing for a whole year. But not only on this platform, have we all individually, as well as in a group, used our voices, but we've also, I feel like we've done a great thing in teaching this generation how to seek him. You know, we always hear, oh, seek him, you know, seek ye first, you know, the kingdom of God. We hear all those scriptures, we hear everything, but we don't get taught, how do I seek him? How do I go to God in prayer? How do I, you know, how do I talk to somebody of not a higher ranking, but how do I go to God? How do I submit? How do I, you know, just fall, you know, here, fall on my face? How do I do all of that? So I believe that this generation is one where we actually are seeking him. We are seeking his face. We are down on our faces in prayer, doing whatever we need to do to see him and get to him. But it's also, you know, also comes to learning how to do so. So I think that's the main thing. We're doing it, but it's also up to the ones like us who are doing it to teach others who don't know how, or who are struggling with theirs, to how, you know, how to seek his face as well.
Amen. Amen. I love the fact that what you said, it's also in the leadership understanding how to groom you all to be able to seek him. And I think that that's very important. I want to go now to, can I just call him Minister Jarrell? I want to ask Minister Jarrell the same question. Is this the generation? Is this that generation that seeks him?
Minister Jarrell, how y'all doing again? I have to agree with my sister, and I'm going to piggyback off of one specific thing that she said. Yes, I do believe that this is the generation that seeks him. And as Micah just stated, there is a sense of fire in our generation. And I don't necessarily think that it has anything to do with anything else outside of the fact that we've experienced so many things. We've experienced so much pressure, so much pain, so much hurt, that it has created this want and this yearning to do better. There's so many different avenues, and even out in and outside of the church, that millennials are finding to make money, to start a businesses, to just get in and get what they want and get what we think that we deserve, or we know that we deserve, and what we desire. And in doing so, there is that generation. There is an urgency and a want to seek after the creator, the one who drives us to create and create these things that we do. So yes, I do 100% believe that this is the generation that seeks him. And I do agree with my sister. It's a crazy fire. It's very spontaneous, very like daring. We have no fear because we want to win. We want to succeed. So I agree.
Amen. Amen. I love it. And And let me go ahead and ask Miss Maya, is this the generation that seeks him?
Yes. For me, yes. I can agree to, like I said, to Mike and Jarrell, yes. It is because one, I'm just going from my personal experience, because if I don't have nobody to talk to, I will open up my book, my Bible. I will go to the specific Bible verse that I know, or I would just say, you know, Lord, I need you, Lord, I need that, all this, that. And it's like, if I can't have nobody to talk to, I will go to God. So it's like, if you don't have nobody to talk to, God is like the only one that, you know, that you can seek him. And it's like, many of people today don't seek him. Many of people don't know him. When you be like, do you know Jesus? They be like, who is that? Oh, God, he created God, earth, heaven, all the above, salvation, sin, blood, turn water into wine.
Wow.
He's a healer. He's a maker. He's a don't. All I got to say is yes. Next.
Child, come on.
God. She gave me chills, y'all. Like, excuse me.
Wow. She told you, Dr. Roberta, she said that's the quiet storm right there.
What? Yeah, that is the definite quiet storm. You weren't expecting that one.
Oh my God. Amen. I love it. I love it. I love it. I'm okay. Listen, I was gonna wait because I know that he was trying to catch up. Pastor Christian, is this? I think God just saved the best for last. Is this the generation that seeks him?
Good evening, everyone. And yes, thank you for letting me catch up. I do apologize, y'all. I had to get my medicine and all that stuff. Sorry, I'm not 100% camera ready. I agree with everything that I've heard my siblings say. And simplistically for me, it is. This is the generation that is not seeking religion, not seeking status, not seeking titles, not seeking degrees. They just want God. They just want him. They want authenticity. They want truth and nothing but the truth. I think because of, and of course we won't get too deeply into this conversation on tonight because that's kind of what spawned millennial conversations. But I think that there was a display for so many generations of, can I just be completely real and open and honest, of Pharisees and Sadducees mentality. And that's what we saw. And this generation says, no, I may not know all the scriptures, but I know that Jesus wept and I know he did it for me. I may not know everything that happened. I may not know that he hung from the 6th hour to the 9th hour. I may not know exactly what day he died on. I may not know the Hebrew, the homiletics, the hermeneutics. I may not know all of those things, but I know that he's real. And I know that he kept me. And I know that he has a plan for me. And though my path may not look the way that you want it to look, I'm not ashamed of my scars. And unlike what I've seen in the Pharisees and Sadducees, what I choose to do, speaking of this generation, is I choose to be open and honest about this is what I'm dealing with. I'm not coming here faking about it. I'm not coming here lying about it. This is exactly how I feel about it. Yes, I have a question about that because we just doing it. Why are we doing that? What are we doing it for? I need to know because I'm not just doing things out of repetition in vain understanding, but I need to know and understand. And this generation, there is, I was talking to another pastor earlier this week. There is discipline that I feel this generation does need to have. But when they've gotten it and when they get it, the glory that follows after is unlike anything I've ever seen. And it's a true pursuit of just real authentic move of God and nothing more, nothing more. I know that we can be a little flashy to the other generations and, you know, kind of, you know, sometimes we can be a little too flashy, but at the core of the heart, man looks at the outward appearance, God looks at the heart. At the heart, in the core of this generation, it's a true desire for God to move and for him to get the glory because we understand and know that he's the reason. I may not always display it the way you want me to display it, but I understand that he's the reason. I may not be able to articulate it the way that you want me to articulate it, but he's the reason.
Yes, God. Yes, God. Amen. And while you are yet talking, I'm going to go ahead and start with you with the next question. What do you believe is the number one focus for the millennials in 2021?
Authenticity. For me, it actually took a while. I started this at 10 years old, and I actually told God several times, I don't want to minister to my generation at all. I was actually more comfortable ministering to those that were my elders. Because I had an old soul and because I had started ministry so young, I didn't like speaking to my generation. What I found, and I always tell this testimony just because it was such a great move of God, and it was nothing more. Because I think, like I said, a lot of times we see the lights and how flashy this generation can be, and you know, the flyers and the lights and the smoke and the camera and the action, that we think that's what they're looking for. I started young adult Bible studies in my house. Micah, you were there. No cameras, no lights, no action, just us in the living room in my home, reading the word of God, studying, and then saying to them, y'all go take 5 minutes in each corner, find a place, pray. And when you're done, we're gonna come and grab hands together and we're gonna pray until we feel the power of God shift us. And we would do that, and deliverance, healing.
Let me stop you for a second though, mm-hmm. and ask you before you go on. So the kind of the mentality and mode of the church right now is the lights, camera, action. Mm-hmm. That we've got to create this environment mm-hmm. in order for the young adults to come in. So what you're saying is that the millennial is not necessarily interested in that. The millennial is interested in, help me to understand.
Yeah, because see, here's the thing about that. They don't need that to come in, because this generation will bring that in with them. Mm. What they need to actually draw them in. And see, the problem is we're trying to do it ourselves just to bring them into the sanctuary, but we have no substance for them to stand on. Says faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And I tell people all the time, if you go and look in that dictionary, in the dictionary, the Merriam-Webster's dictionary of that word substance, it means it's a tangible thing, solid thing that you can stand on. And so we're trying to bring them in with all the pump and the prime, thinking that that's what they're looking for, but we have nothing to give them when they get there. And then we're wondering why they leave, even with having the lights, the camera, and the action. Or we're wondering why they leave the same way they came in, even with the lights, camera, and action. And it's because we didn't give them what they really needed. They'll bring in the lights, the camera, and the action because they're gifted to do so. And this is the generation they grew up in. But what they actually need is the authenticity. It was nothing in there but us. We grabbed hands, we prayed, and everything they need, they got. We had people giving testimonies about drug addiction, about sex addiction, all kinds of stuff that I didn't even ask questions. They just started coming out their mouth saying, this is what I've been dealing with, and today I want to lay it down. Right there in the living room of my home, on our faces. And that's what they're looking for. But what I gave them was just, here's the word. You got questions here. Let me answer this question. Let me help you understand. And then let me give you a moment to go with God, process it. And I don't want you to have no music to try to pump you and get you into the emotionalism. I want you to go over there and speak to God for yourself, because I know you've been seeking him. And he says, knock and it shall be open. Seeking ye shall find. That's all they need. And then they started bringing ideas to me of, it's no different than the millennial chat. This started one night on a conversation just like this. And now it's growing to where the millennials are saying, hey, we can do a podcast. Hey, we can do this. Hey, we can do that. They'll bring it in if you have substance for them to stand on.
Ooh, wait a minute. Let me, hold on. Where can I run? Michael, let me go.
Pastor, let me jump in there.
I know you just off the, because I don't even know what to say. I'm just going to let you just talk. Just
let me hop in there real quick. Christian, you done said so many. Look, Pat, we joke. He the pastor of the family. We joke and we take everything from him. So if you hear us say it, he probably said it first. We just take it. But Christian, you said something that, well, one, to answer your question, Pastor Roberta, of what do I believe the millennials, you know, the number one focus of millennials are, I think that it is, and Christian, you attested to it, it's the foundation. And you said it, Christian, we so often as the church, we're going through the motions. So this is what my great grandmama and my grandmama and my mama's mama, and like, this is what they did. So now you're bringing in a new generation and you're telling them, oh, well, this is what we've been doing for, no offense, 60 plus years, but we want you to accommodate to what we've been doing, and we're not accommodating to how you are growing up in society. Because, and it's funny because I'm thinking about it now, I just did a college essay about the internet. And to think about it, the internet hasn't been around maybe 30, 40 years, 40 plus, maybe it's like early 90s that it came out. But that switch from, you know, my mother's generation from being born in like the 1960s versus me being born in the early 2000s, those are two completely different generations. So we're going through the motions from previous generations and they're wanting us to adapt to them, but they're not adapting to us. But it's that foundation that what we're looking for. You know, you go on TikTok or Instagram, you see all these videos of people, you know, picking out scriptures from the Bible and, you know, trying to teach you about different things. But where's the foundation? Where's the substance? Like, tell me more. This isn't no quick 30, 60 second video that is going to bless my soul. I need some foundation. I need some encouragement. And so that's, you know, in a sense where this conversation, this millennial conversations came from. We had a discussion about how this generation is so lost in the foundation of the word. Like, go to the basics with me. What is sin? I know Adam and Eve came into the world. She bit this apple. He ate after her and sin was created. What else? But tell me what else is sin. Tell me what is sin in the Bible. Take me to the scripture. Take me to not only what is sin, but what's God's grace? What's the after fact, you know, the aftermath of the sin? How can I get his grace, his mercy, his love? You know, point out, you know, you go to the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not. Well, take me to it, love. You know, take me there. Teach it to me. Sit down with me. This isn't a vacation Bible school and we go to school for a week and learn about the Bible. Then the next, we got 6 weeks of summer left and we're going to forget about it. Teach me. Teach me, and you know, we always talk about sowing seeds. Sow a seed into me that's gonna bless and fulfill and be fruitful and multiply in my life, in my ministry, and what God has for me. Like, sow a seed into me, plant something into me, deeply root something into me. You know, help me go through it. Like Christian was talking about his Bible studies. He taught one time about breaking up the foundation. Sometimes we gotta break it up. We got to tear some roots out. We got to get some things together, but it's not going to happen if we keep going through the motions. Change is necessary, but it's not going to happen. So that's what I think. I think we need some foundation. I think that teach me the basics. I love the basics. Teach me that. That's what
As a pastor, I can say that sometimes I think it seems to us that you all are bored though, when we start just talking about scripture only. It seems like you all are bored. What I want to do is spin off to that question. So we just off our list. Jarrell, do you feel that we focus too much on appearance than focusing on the word? Do you feel like we're focused too much on that? And I'm talking about from clothes to hair to everything.
You asked the tattooed minister. Huh? Yes,
that's who I'm coming for.
Do I believe that we focus more on appearance? Honestly, a couple of months back, maybe a year back, I could agree with you, and I would say yes. I think that the church has begun to allow, has begun not to allow. Visual appearance take away from what we bring to the table.
Give me one.
I mean that in
Jarrell, because I know you're gonna be listen. You're about to give us something really, really, really deep. I know you're about to give us something really, really, really deep. And so, what I'm gonna do though, before you get into that, let me go ahead and let's take our commercial break right now. I want everybody listen. Go find somebody. Like, tag, and share like, tag, and share into this conversation, because we are literally dealing and diving into the deep water of millennial conversations of trying to help us to understand how to make this vehicle called the church move with the millennials with us. So we'll be right back after this short commercial break. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Blessings. We are back. Listen, we're in a heated conversation right now with some millennials about the church. And I just asked the one that is perfect to answer this question. The question I asked him is, because the conversation previously was that millennials want the word. And we're focused on lights, camera, action, but they really want to know. You know, Minister Michael said, what is sin? And let's just get a little bit deeper than Adam and Eve. Can we go a little bit further than that since you're the preacher? And now I'm asking Jarrell, are we just so inundated and focused on the clothes, the hair, all of that, that we can't get into the word? Is that what you believe is going on with us?
Thank you for that question again. And like I was stating, I think again maybe a year ago, maybe two, I feel like the church was a lot more focused on appearance, and a lot of times, and I've experienced it myself. I've gone places, and certain people may not want me to pray, or certain people may not want me to sing because of the way that I may carry myself, or the way that I dress, or I got tattoos. I'm still gonna keep getting tattoos, but. My tattoos, my appearance, my hair, my dreads, whatever the case for the ladies, the whole not wearing pants to church thing, like that was something that I grew up around. And I just never really grasped the concept. Like, why is it that what I'm wearing to church take away from the gifts that God has placed inside of me? So now, looking at it based upon the churches that I fellowship with, my church, your church, Pastor Roberta, my brother's church, and other churches around the city that I fellowship with frequently, the conversation about appearance is no longer a major relevant thing. However, y'all know me, I'm always keeping 100% real. There is a way that I believe, millennial or not, that you should carry yourself when you come into the house of God. That's point blank, period. I don't care how tattooed you want to be or how you want to carry yourself outside of the house. There is a level of respect I feel like that you should still have. But and to answer your question simplistically, no, I don't believe that it's no longer a problem. Now, maybe, and when I say that, I mean it, maybe in most churches. I don't know. I can only speak for what I'm around now. But from what I've seen, the conversation about appearance is no longer a relevant thing. And I hope that it continues to stay that way, because you never know what gifts people are carrying. You never know what ways it can bless your life. And if you are quick to shut someone down just because of the way they look or how many tattoos I have on, you may miss out on your blessing.
Ooh, he just said something. He said, if you focus more on the outward appearance than you, because listen, and I can say this, and I can, you know, I'm not just saying this just because I love them and because they're family, but his mom had a conference about maybe, I can't remember what month it was.
November.
It was November. This was a conference that was geared around mental health. And I walked in, and I think actually she had messaged me like earlier or so and say, Pastor, do you mind opening up in prayer? And but when we got there, I think we were a few minutes behind or something like that. And Jarrell was up praying. And all of us older generation people were sitting there listening to him pray, going, okay, I think that I'm behind in praying. I think I need to kind of go back to the altar and go, I think I need to go deeper. He prayed the paint out of the building, and this is a new building. And I'm talking, this was not prayer. This was not soulish prayer. This was not want to be seen prayer. This was prayer that was focused totally on the Father. And it was so specific to the needs in the house, yet he wasn't per se focusing on anybody in the house. And so it brought back to the place of what he said. If you look at a person and assume by appearance that they can't do something, then you may be missing out on the greatest part of them, because he literally brought the presence of God in there like no other intercessor that I'd ever experienced bringing in the presence of God. It was just absolutely amazing. I'm going to move on to the next question, and I'm going to go to, I'm going to start with you, Ms. Angela, because we're going to let them go. We're going to let them go for it. But I want to start with you. Are millennials tired of going to a building for worship and fellowship? Do you feel that?
I don't. I think that, yes, we are in a year and years of social media, you know, all the different aspects of it. But I think, again, I'm with them, the same thing. I think, well, we as the leaders in the church, we need to get to the point where we stop forgetting where we came from. I think that is what is causing the millennials, youth, young adult, not to want to come to the house of God, because we forgot where we came from. We forgot that we wore the jeans and the tennis shoes, and we wore things that our parents was like, oh my God, I can't believe you wearing that. Or we said things that the way we said it wasn't the way they wanted us to say it. And that's the same with this generation. And I think that we as a body, we have to move past the hymns are great. And believe me, my kids, you know, I know from me, I taught them, they know the hymns. They know, you know what I'm saying? They know those hymns and things, but we have to move past and allow them to be a part of the ministry as a whole. I think when they don't want to show up to the house, it's because we want them to sit a certain way. We want them to sing a certain way. We want them to praise God a certain way. We want them to dance a certain way. And it's not about that. And if you remember, that is why I'm able to do what I am able to do with youth, and how I connect with them is because I didn't forget that I was a little girl, a teenager and a college student with two kids, not married. I didn't forget that I was a PK. My daddy, my mama were pastors, and out there, you know, I liked guys. You see what I'm saying? So I think that they're not tired of the church, but they're tired of the fake church. Because a lot of us parents, and I just have to say it, a lot of us parents at church, we want one way. But when we get in that car to go home, we a whole nother way. And they like, well, you sitting up in church with your lap scarf, your hat tipped to the side. But when you get in the car, you jamming, you know, all these other things, or you talking to your kids like they somebody off the street. That's why they don't want to come into the building. They don't care nothing about the building, but they don't want to come and sit in there and watch you fake and funk for everybody else. But then when you get in the car, I can't even ask you, mama, you know, what we eating without you flying off the handle. So I think where it is, and the reason they don't want to come, is back to the same thing, the foundation. What are we showing them?
I think also, and I'm coming to you right next, Jarrell, I think also the church, to me, and again, I'm just one of those pastors where I love when God grows me. And I love the fact that I can say beyond a shadow of a doubt that I have evolved as a leader, that I've come from forgetting where I came from to understanding that that's how you draw others. And I think that the greatest part of the church, which is what you're talking about, is the fact that I believe that the church has been, to me, somewhat too centered around trying to save people. I think that's been our focus. We've been totally centered around trying to save people and not focused on drawing those who don't know him and making them feel like it's okay to come and be a part of the family. And so I believe that that's a great thing, and that's a place that we need to start in our hearts. Jarrell.
Thank you. I agree with my mother, of course. And this is a question that goes amongst me and my conversations with my friends. It's not necessarily that millennials are tired of going to church. It's not that at all. It's like my mom just said, I'm tired of coming into a church of no transparency. I'm tired of coming to a church where I walk in and everybody else is cool, but I'm not cool because I may have just went to the club last night. Like that point of church, yes, that if you use that as an example as to why we're tired of going to church or going into a building, yes, I'd rather be at home and I'd rather watch TD Jakes or G-Top or Pastor Roberta at home in my own comfort zone where I can show my tattoos and I can be chill. And maybe I don't want to wear dress pants to church. I'd rather sit in my living room and watch television on TV before I walk into a building of non-transparency. And even going as far as, and I think this is me speaking from a being in church so long. When I say transparency, I don't just mean transparency in the preaching. I mean transparency in the entire church. A lot of times we allow people to come into buildings because they have the nicest voices, or they have the biggest names in the cities, or we talked about this in one of our millennial conversations before. Or everybody comes to every, we bring this pastor and this preacher and this singer and this person in here because they can draw the people into the building. But this praise and worship leader might have a bad attitude. This praise and worship leader, the pastor may not even like children. Just little things, and you expect millennials to come, this generation of millennials, you expect us to come and sit inside of a building where we can see right through that, or we're sitting up here and we're coming into a building that we just saw the preacher, his wife, and two other people at the club last night, and now you're in here trying to tell me that I'm wrong and condemning me for my lifestyle and the things that I choose to do. That's what I mean by transparency. And so, yes, to answer your question, if I'm walking into a building where I no longer feel that they're going to be transparent or feel that I'm going to be welcomed for me as I am, I'm not going. it's a little meme going around right now that says, if I got a fake smile, I'm not going. I'm not coming. And my siblings, my mama, they all know me. That's how I am. I'm too real to be fake around people. Yes, I still have things I need to work on. Yes, I still have things I want to grow on and better my life in God. However, I live my life transparently. Everything, you can ask me anything, and they can attest to this. Friends, family, coworkers, classmates, they can ask me absolutely anything. And I'm going to be honest. I'm going to be transparent because I never want to forget, like you two said before, I never want to forget where I came from. I don't want to become so great, so successful, and so saved that I can't go have a pink lemonade at BB's with my friends, because just that part of that's irritating. That's irritating to us as millennials now. So.
I appreciate the transparency because it's absolutely what's needed. Now, I know that the show is we don't have that long on the show left, but I have to bring back Pastor Christian, because Pastor, you being in this age range, but have been already elevated to the office of a pastor. And so I want to also help to answer some questions. So based off of what Jarrell said and Ms. Angela, your mom said, based off of the conversation that we're having right now, how have you found ways to bridge the gap with us, with this? Because what I'm finding for myself is that when you're a pastor, you have to feed everybody in the house. And you have to, you know what I'm saying? You have to feed everybody in the house. You got to feed the 4-year-old, the 16-year-old, the 20-year-old, the 26-year-old, the 35-year-old, the 44-year-old, the 60-year-old, the 70-year-old. You got to feed everybody in the house. You have to, because it's a church. And so it's more than just millennials in the building. And so I think pastors are also having a difficult time trying to understand, especially again, now I'm not dealing per se with a mega church situation. I'm not dealing with that. A mega church situation, you have the building, you got the facility, you have different, you know, places for people to go to get that done. But most churches now are not that large. Most churches, I would say the majority of churches, believe it or not, most churches are at least 50 members or less. So when you're 50 members or less, you have everybody in the same room. This is not a split up situation. And so when you're dealing with that, then pastors are asking, how do we bridge the gap in this conversation to be able to make sure that we're feeding those that are older, but also not making the younger culture feel uncomfortable, vice versa, feeding the younger culture and not making the older culture feel uncomfortable. Can you kind of expound on that a little for me?
So I'm 24. I'll be 25 this year. Been doing ministry for 14 years, and I do have an old soul. But it goes back to a genuine want and authentic move of God. We have spent so much time, for instance, I've grown and learned certain things in ministry as I've gone, so I know how to conduct myself in certain houses. You know, if I go to this house, if I'm on the program to be a psalmist or even to preach, I know before I preach, if I get up there and I say, Jesus keep, it's not even about the fact that I'm anointed and God is on it. It's the fact that that's just what you heard and that's what you associated with this. And that's what's tagged into your emotions about what you done been through. So that church gonna go up. I know if I go to this one over here and I say, living, he loved me, dying, he saved, they gonna go in with me. I know if I go over here and I say, Spirit lead me where my trust is without. So I've learned those things. But what I've more so understood is the more that I got in tune with God and I brought to the table a pastor's heart. And I think that a lot of leaders in leadership, and not even excluding age gap here, just leaders in general, we have forgotten that that's what we're supposed to bring to the table, a pastor's heart. My heart aches when you walk out of here and you don't understand what I just said. My heart aches when you don't feel like you can come in here and just lift your hands and be yourself. My heart aches when your family is going through something and you need a word. My heart aches when you come in here and I can see that you're bringing these burdens to the altar. My heart aches when I walk through a door on a Sunday morning and I understand that this atmosphere needs to be shifted because I feel the weight that of everything that everybody is going through. And it's my responsibility to make sure that what you hear out of my mouth, that you don't hear me, that the people, I always pray, Lord, let the people only see, hear, and know you in me. help me preach to the end that sinners are saved, lives are changed, and the body of Christ is edified, because this has absolutely nothing to do with me. But I have a true pastor's heart that when you hurt, I hurt. When you're in victory, I'm in victory. And the problem is, us as leaders, we're waiting for the body of Christ to catch on to this. And us as the head, the leaders, are not showing this concept. When I was in the hospital yesterday, woke up about 6:30 in the morning, the nurse came in there, woke me up and then left, sitting there in ICU, probably 30 generations ran through me. Because I went from, our God is an awesome God, he reigns, Kirk Franklin, to, I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. All of that is what pulled inside of me. But all of that had nothing to do with age, had nothing to do with generation, had everything to do with my encounter with God. And when I fell on my face and said, okay, God, and those are the songs that brought me through. And it had to do with the authentic relationship. And so when I get up to preach, even at 24 years old, and I've had people from elder generations who, mind you, I'm somebody who a lot of people do prejudge off of just seeing me. And a lot of speculation goes, until I mount a pulpit and grab a mic to deliver what God has told me to do. And then whether it's by age, whether it's by appearance, whether it's by mannerism, whatever it is that they've prejudged me for, well, now you're experiencing the glory of God. And so now from the older generation, I get, wow, I'm impressed because I study and I understand the word. And I get from the younger generation, well, no, you're not fake. Absolutely not. Because when you come to me, and you come to me, I don't care if you're Archbishop so-and-so, this and this and that, you're all going to get the same thing, from the janitor to the people who hold the doors, to the stripper that came in off of the pole and went to sit down in the first row or in the back row. Y'all are all going to get a hug. Y'all are all going to get a pastor's heart, because I want you to be the best version of yourself. God gave me 3 pillars when I first started ministry. And it's been what I've stood by, Pastor. And it's simplistically, I tell people all the time, I don't preach perfection. I preach promise, progression, and purpose. They're tired of coming into the ecclesia and the church and experiencing cycles and not Christ.
Wow.
I'll say that again. That's what the, and it doesn't matter what generation you're in, people, the body of Christ is tired of coming into the ecclesia, into the church building, and experiencing cycles and not Christ. Because Christ's purpose was to bring us into consecration that we may be removed from cycles. Mm-hmm. But culture says we're going to stay in these cycles because that's where we are most comfortable. Cycles equals comfortability. Christ equals consecration and newness. Mm. And that's where we have to get. I bring a pastor's heart. As I sat there yesterday and sang all those things, hummed all of them, and tears began to roll down my eyes sitting there, because I was just simplistically grateful that he kept me. Mm. He kept me. There was no Greek. There was no Hebrew. I didn't go through all the scriptures. Simplistically, somebody could have came in there and just as Jesus did, and we minimize that scripture because a lot of us think so much of ourselves. Jesus wept meant quite a lot. Jesus wept meant quite a lot. And yesterday I understood what Luke 9:23 really meant when Christian wept. And that's what I bring when I mount a pulpit, that all of us, including myself first. Last Sunday, God had me preach from grief to glory. I understood that that's where I was.
Wow.
And by God revealing to me where I was, putting the mirror up to me where I was, he had then put the mirror up to the people of where we are as a body. And this is where he's trying to get us. And so if we would get back to, in our own private relationships with God, being Christ-centered and him being the centric focal point.
Wow.
That's the problem. We got to get back to the blueprint that he left. This is not it. He said, love one another as I have loved you. That is an unconditional, unrestrained, undignified type of love. What we're showing is human nature. And that is what's causing the hearts of the sons and the fathers not to turn to one another. There has to be this turning, and the turning only comes by transformation in both generations. For the young are strong, but the old know the way. And that's where we're supposed to be. And I think it's us as leaders. I don't care if your title is apostle, evangelist, teacher, whatever your title is, drop every one of those things. I know anybody who has heard me lead praise and worship has heard me say that before. Drop every title. And I say that everywhere I go because I need you to understand this is not about your title. And I need you to go to that pure, authentic Psalm 91 place in your relationship with God. I need that to overflow, that he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty God. That's where I need you to be. When nobody is watching you, when you really remember and think about where you have been and where he's brought you from, because praise will change your problem. Worship will change your posture.
Yes, God. Well, I am. Oof. Listen. Thank you for giving church to all of those that didn't make it to the house of God today. Listen, this has been so amazing. Y'all know this won't be your last time on this show. I'm sitting here in awe, literally, of the conversation and the wisdom that has been brought to us through each one of you as you spoke today. I'm sitting here in awe. Emmanuel Worship Center is 10 years this year, 10 years. And I will always at least say to myself, I'm always the pastor that keeps going back to the Father and saying, how can I do better? How can I do better? How can I do better? And then I'm willing to listen. I'm willing to bring people in and ask the questions that we may not want to know the answer to, because of course we've also always been, we understand as pastors that we receive our vision from God, okay? We receive our vision from God, and then we give that vision to the people. And according to Habakkuk 2, it says what? Write the vision and make it plain on tablets that he that read it may run with it. And I think the reality, though, is that a lot of pastors are unwilling to say, I don't understand the vision myself. How can I make it plain to the people when it's unclear to me? Because as we all know, God does not give you the whole picture. He gives you the outline. He gives you, like Joseph, you're in your beginning and he gives you the ending. And as I've always said with Joseph, had God showed him the pit, had he showed him being sold into slavery, had he showed him being accused of rape, had he showed him being put in prison and then being abandoned by his friends that was able to get out of jail because they used his vision to get out of jail. You know what I'm saying? Had God showed him all of that, he'd have said in the beginning, I'm not doing this. And so God doesn't give us the whole picture. And so Pastor Christian, I know that a lot of times we get messed up right in the middle where God is taking us through the pit. He's taking us through, you know, our name being scandalized and slandered and all of that type of stuff. He's taking us through that stuff to refine us. And so I'm just like, my God, you know, how do we bring this vision to pass, knowing that it's a God-given vision, but we can only bring it to pass when we bring other people into the conversation, and we bring into the conversation those who they may not give you the answer that you want to hear, because a lot of stuff that you just said, Pastor Christian, if you are a pastor that wears your feelings on your shoulders or whatever, or you got your chest stuck out, man or woman, whatever, you know what I'm saying? What a lot of things that you just said right now would step on our toes, because it hurts to hear from a millennial tell a pastor, you need to get back to the altar. Because essentially that's what you said. Just to sum up everything that you said, go to the altar, get back to the altar, go find your place in God. Once you find your place in God, then you can find your place with the people. And that's essentially what you said. And sometimes it hurts, but it helps. And so I just want to thank you all for taking the time out of your Sunday to come here and spend time with us today to help us to hear this conversation. I applaud your mother for not abandoning the gifts like some people do and focus only on their self, but her greatest desire is to help to groom those gifts and to be there in any way that she possibly can. And I love the fact that she respects each one of you for where you are in God. And she allows you to make your mistakes, get back up and keep pressing on. And I love that. And that's what parents need to understand. None of us are perfect, but listen, the Bible says what a good man falls seven times, but he gets back up again. And so I just thank y'all for this conversation. I thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. And so listen, I just want to remind us that the Promise Talk Show, we are here to have these conversations. We're here to put the information out so that it can be obtained by many people. This is not based on race. This is based on God. And I also, again, want to just thank God for Boss Up Houston, who makes sure that this conversation is not just local, but it's going national, international right now. So I want to also tell you, if you desire to host a show, if you have a commercial, if you have a platform, you need something to be highlighted or spotlighted, make sure that you reach out to Boss Up Houston and make sure that you allow them to sponsor your program or to be able to put that information out there. She'll be able to present you with different packages to help you to be able to get your information to a much larger scale. Amen. So again, I just want to remind us that the Bible says, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, that the promises of God are yes and in him. Amen. And before we close, I'm going to allow Minister Micah to just give us that final word. We got about 30 seconds. Amen.
Well, thank you all for tuning in. Of course, if y'all want to tune in to Millennial Conversations live,